This episode of the Art of Manliness podcast is brought to you by Athletic Greens. Life can be unpredictable, so it's important to be prepared for anything. That's why I add a scoop of Athletic Greens to my morning smoothie every day. With 75 ingredients working together to help with 11 different areas of health, Athletic Greens is much more than just another greens product. It's the most complete whole food supplement available, plus it tastes fantastic. Head over to athleticgreens.com/AOM and claim your special offer there today. Again, athleticgreens.com/AOM. Brett McKay here, and welcome to another edition of the Art of Manliness podcast. Now, for many men, marriage is seen as an institution that at best stifles them, or at worst sets them up for divorce, and as a result, financial and emotional ruin. But research is coming out in recent years that suggests that marriage actually offers a lot of benefits to men, from making more money, to having a better sex life, and enjoying a healthier, longer life. Today on the podcast, I talked to one of those researchers. His name is Brad Wilcox. He's a professor of sociology at the University of Virginia, as well as the director of the National Marriage Project. He spent his career researching the impact of marriage has on people's lives. And today on the show, Brad and I discuss the effect marriage has on men and why officially tying the knot actually makes a significant difference compared to being in a committed, non-married relationship. We also discuss what men can do to create a lasting marriage and even the best age to get hitched. We then shift gears, talk about his research on fatherhood, particularly the importance of dads in a child's life and the benefits men get themselves from being a dad. Whether you're already married and a dad or thinking about popping the question, you're going to find a lot of insights and surprising information in this podcast. After the show's over, make sure to check out the show notes at aom.is/menandmarriage. Brad Wilcox, welcome to the show.
It's great to be here, Brett.
So you're a professor of sociology at the University of Virginia. You're also the director of the National Marriage Project and a senior fellow at the Institute of Family Studies for Family Studies. And you do a lot of research about marriage, fatherhood, and particularly marriage in men and the benefits that men get from it, as well as the benefits children and the greater society gets from men being married. So I'd love to dig into your research a bit. I feel like for men in marriage today in America, it's either seen as something at best, you know, will restrain you, hold you back, or at worst, you're just setting yourself up for being fleeced in divorce courts. But you've done a lot of research showing these benefits that come from marriage. What are some of those benefits that men get from being married?
So when it comes to the most kind of basic goods in life, what we find is that men who are stably married earn more money, have more assets, they do better when it comes to their health, and they even enjoy better quality sex lives. So kind of in some basic goods that concern, you know, many ordinary guys, money, health, and sex, we see that men who are stably married are much more likely to be doing well on those outcomes compared to their peers who are both single and divorced.
So what's going on there? So for example, you know, why do men who are married make more money? Because some would say there's a selection bias going on there. Men who are able to maintain a stable relationship probably have attributes that allow them to, you know, go up the corporate ladder. I mean, is that what's going on or is there something else?
Well, certainly part of the story here is what we call selection, where the types of men who get and stay married are more likely to have, say, good jobs, perhaps better social skills, and other, you know, traits that make them more attractive as husbands. But it's also the case too that when we kind of look at guys over the life course, what we see is that when men get married, they tend to work harder, and they work more hours and they make more money. And also when men get divorced, they tend to often cut back on hours and earn less money. So it's the state of marriage itself that looks like it's having an impact on men. There's also been a twin study in Minnesota showing that married twins were doing better financially than their unmarried twin brothers. So that's kind of a pretty compelling evidence or something about marriage per se that helps men do better in today's workforce.
And, you know, with the set, you said that marriage can actually increase the quality of a man's sex life. A lot of guys put off marriage because like, oh, well, let's have this one partner, it'll get boring. So don't want to do that. So why is it that marriage can improve a man's sex life?
Well, you know, one study found that 54% of men said that they were extremely satisfied with the physical quality of their sex if they were married, compared to 44% of cohabiting guys and 43% of single guys. That same survey also found that men reported they were more satisfied with the emotional quality of their sexual lives if they were married versus being cohabiting or single. So, you know, I think this sort of runs, you know, counter to a lot of what you might see on MTV or YouTube or movies or shows, where kind of there's this image out there that the single guys or the cohabiting guys get the best sex. In reality, guys who have a ring on their finger tend to enjoy the highest quality sex. And I think that's for a couple of reasons. One is that, you know, even for guys, a sense of commitment, a sense of trust and security matters in the average sexual relationship. And marriage tends to deliver more security, more commitment, and more trust than the alternatives for guys. And the second thing that's worth, I think, noting about sex is it looks like you know, couples who are married are more likely to kind of invest in one another in a whole variety of ways, you know, financially, practically, but also sexually. And so if you're stably married, there's kind of an incentive and an orientation to try to figure out what your, you know, what your spouse, you know, likes and to do that. So kind of to be more sensitive to your partner in the bedroom is just one way of understanding this finding.
Right. I think the report that just came out about, men in marriage, I mean, it did state that married and cohabitating men have more sex than single men, which is makes sense if you're single, like you don't have a sexual partner there. But cohabitating men typically have more sex than married men, but they report the quality of sex not to be that great.
Well, right. So it's important to know, actually, so cohabiting men have the most sex, followed then by married men, and followed finally by single guys. But again, when it comes to reports of the quality, both the emotional quality of the sex and the physical quality of sex, we see that married men tend to do better than both their cohabiting and single peers. So again, I think we might think about sex as, you know, something that's more exotic, you know, whatever else is going to be the most exciting or the best sex. But if you kind of look at, you know, sort of sex in general, again, what we're finding is the guys who are doing it in a married context are more likely to report that they're happy with both the emotional and physical quality of that sex.
And what about the physical and mental health benefits of marriage for men?
Well, we know that men who are married tend to be in better physical health and better emotional health. So, for instance, if you look at recent data among guys in their 20s and 30s and ask them, you know, if they're very happy with life, what we find is the guys who are younger men, again, men in between 20 and 38, are about twice as likely to say that they're very happy with life if they're married versus single or cohabiting. So it's a pretty strong association there in some recent data from the general social survey. And then when it comes to physical health, we know that guys tend to do better on a whole bunch of outcomes. They tend to be less stressed, their immune systems tend to function better, and they tend to recover from things like cancer more quickly and more commonly if they're married. And it looks like guys live about 9 years longer if they're stably married than their single or divorced peers. And so if, you know, if you're the kind of guy, for instance, who likes to smoke, it looks like sort of the positive health effects of stable marriage are comparable to the negative health effects of smoking a pack a day. So if you are a smoker, it looks like stable marriage can kind of offset the health effects of regularly smoking. But that's just sort of one example of kind of the power of marriage. And, you know, we hear a lot obviously today about sort of smoking and health. I think what's striking is how little we hear about sort of the power of marriage to help men enjoy both psychologically and physically healthier lives.
There's a lot of statistics coming out showing that younger people, millennials, they're not necessarily remaining single. They're doing a lot of cohabitating. They're not getting married. So, I mean, what is it about marriage compared to cohabitation that gives you these benefits? I mean, a lot of people would argue that, well, when you're married, like things don't really change from just living with your partner. Like all you now have now is a, you know, piece of paper from the state that says you're officially a couple. So, I mean, what is it about marriage that provides these benefits that you probably can't get cohabitating?
Well, you know, marriage is really profoundly different than cohabitation. I mean, a lot of people think about marriage as being just a piece of paper. But, you know, I think one way to think about the difference between the two relationships is think about kind of the terms of entry. And, you know, what's interesting when you ask people sort of when they began to cohabit, if you ask that question of both partners, oftentimes you'll get a different answer, because one partner might count sort of that moment when they started spending three nights a week together, and the other partner might count that moment when, you know, one of the partners moved all of their possessions, you know, into their apartment. But the point is, there isn't kind of one particular moment that marks that entry into cohabitation, you know, for many couples. By contrast, kind of everyone knows their wedding date. And it's usually, you know, a situation where you are getting married in front of friends and family members, you know, often in some kind of religious institution. And, you know, you've got music, you have vows, you have people who are looking at you entering into this new relationship. So it's just a very different way of sort of starting a relationship. And one is much more sort of public and social than the other. And so that kind of different entry is just one example of the way in which marriage, I think, conveys a lot more seriousness, a lot more commitment. And those things then engender more trust, more emotional security, and much more stability. We see today in America, and really, really around the world, that married couples tend to enjoy much more stability than their cohabiting peers. So again, some people are under this misimpression that the only difference between the two things is this piece of paper. But because marriage is a much more committed institution, both individuals, couples, and their larger community of friends and family tend to view a married relationship much differently than a cohabiting one. And it affects how they view their own relationship and how other people trust them. So for instance, folks who are married are much more likely to get financial support and assistance from their parents or their in-laws, so to speak, than couples who are cohabiting, because the parents have more confidence that that support will be kind of going to the couple, and nowadays any kids that they might have, on a kind of more permanent, you know, basis. Another example, a practical example, is that guys who are married tend to save hundreds, if not thousands, of dollars on car insurance compared to their peers who are cohabiting or single. And again, this is because, you know, companies have done the numbers and find that something about marriage that tends to make guys drive more safely. That's just one other indication of the way in which marriage is really a distinctive institution, even today, for today's men.
Yeah, I thought that was interesting, your point about how cohabitation, the date of entry into the relationship, is different for everyone. It's fluid. We had Dr. Meg Jay on the podcast several years ago. She wrote the book, The Defining Decade. She talks about cohabitation as you're sort of sliding into a relationship. Right? Like, you're not really making a firm commitment. You're just kind of just going with the flow, and it just sort of happens. And something about that doesn't provide the stability of making a firm commitment.
Yeah. So cohabitation today gives young adults a lot of freedom and flexibility. And that's obviously appealing and attractive in some ways. But the flip side to that is it doesn't have the same degree of commitment and the same degree of security. And, you know, kind of at our deepest levels, you know, and in our most vulnerable moments, we really want someone who is there for us, you know, where there isn't kind of that freedom to leave if, you know, if you're not that happy in the relationship, you know, at one moment in time. And of course, the other thing that's important to put on the table here as well is that today a lot of younger adults are cohabiting and having kids in those cohabiting relationships. And that is, I think, the most worrisome thing I would say about cohabitation, because those relationships are much less stable than our married relationships. So people are having their kids in a married relationship are much more likely to go the distance with their kids compared to couples who are having a baby in a cohabiting relationship. So again, marriage gives not just adults, but especially kids, a stability premium that's really valuable to the next generation.
Well, yeah, you did a report a while back ago about the rise of unmarried couples who are having children. I mean, besides the stability, what are the other detriments, or the lack of stability? What are some of the other detriments that cohabitation poses to children?
Well, kids in cohabiting relationships are, one, more likely to experience instability. Two, they're more likely to see their parents be physically violent with one another. I think partly because their parents are less likely to have that commitment and trust, you know, guiding their relationship. And kids in cohabiting households are, you know, more likely to sort of sense that trust and commitment isn't as strong or as publicly kind of noted for their parents, you know, as it might be for, you know, say friends down the block, so to speak. So there are just a variety of ways in which, because it entails less commitment and less trust and also actually less sexual fidelity, you know, it's not as ideal for child rearing as marriage is. Now, it's also important in all of this that it's not just sort of a marriage license that matters. It's also kind of a marriage mentality, I think, that matters. And so what I would say is couples who really think of themselves as married, who think of themselves in terms of we, not me, or of we, not I, who think about their marriage in terms of this is a kind of permanent commitment, not a kind of, you know, commitment that's for as long as I shall love. It's those couples who are more kind of committed to marriage and to a lifelong love also tend to, not surprisingly, enjoy more stable relationships. They tend to be happier in their relationships, and they tend to invest more in one another, practically, you know, financially, emotionally, in ways that redound to long-term, typically, to both their own benefit, to the benefit of their spouse, and to the benefit of their kids as well. So again, when we're talking about marriage, it's not just the law, it's not just the license, it's also kind of whether or not a couple kind of really embraces what I would call a marriage mentality, shapes, you know, their odds of enjoying the highest quality relationship.
So what's the state of marriage in America today? Is it still a goal for a lot of people, or is it sort of becoming, you know, pushed to the wayside?
Well, I think marriage is in a kind of a weird spot, because on the one hand, I think that marriage remains the gold standard. It remains kind of the ideal. But, you know, in the pop culture with shows like Bachelor and Bachelorette, with, you know, music and movies, I think we often have an overly idealized vision of marriage as kind of like the soulmate relationship or this romantic relationship where you can signal to your partner and to your friends and to yourself that you've kind of made it, you know, emotionally, relationship-wise, even financially oftentimes today. The problem with that view is it doesn't kind of appreciate, I think, kind of the practical character of marriage and the demands that marriage puts upon us. I mean, marriage, of course, is not, for most of us, is not an easy relationship. It's really oftentimes a pretty hard one to be in a relationship with someone, you know, day in and day out, with all of their faults and failings and with all of your own faults and failings. So I think what's missing oftentimes today is an appreciation of the way in which, you know, marriage is a difficult undertaking, but nevertheless one that's, you know, really important and valuable, you know, both for us adults, for our children, and for our communities and even the country. Because when marriage is strong, we see that kids are more likely to flourish, communities are more likely to be healthy and thriving. And even our own research suggests, you know, that states with stronger marriage cultures tend to do better, for instance, you know, economically, than states that don't have that strong marriage culture. So in terms of talking about kind of the character of marriage, I would say on the plus side, marriage still is an important part of American ideals. And it's also the case on the plus side that we've actually seen divorce come down since the height of the divorce revolution in the 1970s, 1980s. And particularly among college-educated Americans, stable marriage really is sort of the defining feature of family life. The problem, though, when it comes to marriage is that we do see a growing marriage divide in the United States, where working class and poor Americans today are less likely to get and stay married. I think partly because they have kind of the soulmate view of marriage, that everything has to be kind of perfect for them to either get married or stay married. And partly because they have fewer economic resources to navigate married life. And then we're also seeing too that I think a lot of younger adults are needlessly postponing marriage. And because they have kind of this idealized, soulmate model of marriage, that makes them expect perhaps too much of both themselves and potential partners, before they go into marriage. So, those are some of the things that indicate kind of the way in which marriage is not as strong or as powerful as it used to be. And my biggest concern, I guess, in terms of looking at, more negative trends related to marriage and family life is that, a large share of younger folks particularly are having kids outside of marriage. And about 40% of babies now are born outside of marriage. And, that's associated with a lot of instability for those kids and, a number of negative outcomes for those children.
So there's a lot to unpack there. First, so this, the divorce rate being high amongst just working class, high school educated Americans. I mean, is there anything that can be done? Are there any research-backed moves that can be done to help that, improve that?
I think there are really two big things that could be done. One is on the economic front to do more both in the marketplace and in our public policies to strengthen job opportunities for men who don't have college degrees. So for instance, we could do, I think, a much better job in terms of vocational training and apprenticeships on the public policy side of the ledger. And that would help make working class men, less educated men, more economically attractive, I think, as husbands, both in their partners' eyes and also in their own eyes, which is important. On the cultural side of things, I think it's important to stress that we need to do more in terms of public messaging. I think we have with smoking, for instance, and in the popular culture, in our movies, our TV shows, our songs, now our vines, to sort of basically show the power of marriage for younger adults, the way in which, marriage, even though it's, it's demanding and difficult, does, provide us with so many important social goods and personal goods. And then also just to stress, look, if you're expecting a child, if you're looking to have a child, really the best thing you can do for that child is to be married before your child comes along, and then to do everything you can to remain married, once you have, kids. To get those messages out, I think, to the broader culture, and in ways that are sort of accessible and engaging would be really helpful in strengthening marriage and the stability of family life in working class and poor communities.
Are there any pop culture examples where you feel like they're doing a good job with that?
That's a good question. I mean, I think This Is Us is one example of a recent show that does a good job of that. And I think that there are others out there, but I just, I don't have a bunch of those right at the sort of tip of my fingers here.
We're going to take a quick break for your word from our sponsors. All right, I'm curious by nature. There's so much I want to know more about, which is why I enjoy my subscription to the Great Courses Plus. I have unlimited access to their huge library of fascinating video lectures. They're all presented by award-winning and engaging experts. You'll find classes on how to play chess better, how to take better pictures, things about philosophy, history, literature, things about how to do better in your business life. With the Great Course Plus, there's over 8,000 lectures, and there's more added all the time. You can watch them anywhere from your smartphone, tablet, laptop to TV. And as a listener of this podcast, I know you're going to love the Great Courses Plus too. One course I recommend you check out is The Art of Critical Decision Making. It explores how indecision can paralyze us within our culture of yes, no, or maybe. And there's a lot of other great tools to improve your own decision-making process. So if you want to try the Great Courses Plus for free for an entire month, just go to thegreatcoursesplus.com/manliness. Start your free month. You're going to love it. thegreatcoursesplus.com/manliness. Also by Blue Apron. Not all ingredients are created equal. Fresh, high-quality ingredients make a real difference, so it's important to know where your food comes from. Thankfully, for less than $10 per person per meal, Blue Apron delivers easy-to-follow recipes along with pre-portioned ingredients courtesy of over 150 local farms, ranches, and fisheries across the United States right to your door in a box that's packaged with dry ice. It's fantastic. The food at Blue Apron is delicious. I love how there's no food waste when you cook with Blue Apron. And I love it too because we've been able to get the kids on it. They love cooking our Blue Apron meals with us. Been able to teach them some important life skills like how to measure, how to peel things, how to use a knife, things like that that an adult, just a person, a functioning person should know. Some of the upcoming meals are cashew chicken stir fry with tango mandarins and jasmine rice, udon noodle soup with miso and soft boiled eggs, and roasted pork with apple, walnut, and farro salad. Stuff's really delicious. If you want to try Blue Apron, I got a fantastic offer for you. Get your first three meals free with free shipping by going to blueapron.com/manliness. You're going to love how good it tastes to cook meals at home with Blue Apron, so don't wait. blueapron.com/manliness. And now back to the show. So you also mentioned that young people are putting off marriage longer and longer. I think it's the highest since, you know, I think like the 1930s, right? The age of marriage. It was really low in the post-war era. Kids, you know, people were getting married in their early 20s. And a lot of people feel like they need to put off marriage until they have like a job, they finish college, etc. Is that necessarily the case? Do you have to be financially stable in order to start a marriage, or is it okay to start a marriage when you're poor, broke college students?
I think certainly, I mean, I know plenty of folks who have gotten married in graduate school when they were relatively broke and, you know, have done well. But I guess what I would say is that generally speaking, it's valuable to have, I think, at least, some experience in the workforce before getting married. So I would definitely say having, you know, had at least, you know, a year of stable work is a good thing to have under your belt before you go ahead and get married. And we do know that from both the perspective of, you know, of the man and of the woman, that, you know, particularly his stable employment is a major predictor of her willingness to go ahead and get married. And then also kind of the stability of their marriage after that wedding day. So I think it's important to do all you can to kind of find some kind of work. It doesn't have to be, you know, a job that's bringing in, you know, six figures. But I think having had some experience in the labor force can be helpful for kind of grounding people before they go ahead and get married.
Is there an age where, you know, where it's too late? Like, you know, when you, the longer you put off marriage, does it get harder to actually settle down and find a partner?
Well, I think it certainly is somewhat harder for folks after they turn 30, you know, to get married, and particularly as they approach their 40s and beyond to marry. And it's interesting when you look at sort of the link between age at marriage and divorce, and the age at marriage and marital quality, you see somewhat different patterns in terms of kind of what's the ideal age to get married. So when it comes to divorce, it looks like kind of the ideal age to get married is in your late 20s or early 30s. That's when we see kind of the lowest divorce rates for the average American. When it comes to marital quality, we actually have a different story. And there it kind of looks like getting married in your mid-20s is kind of ideal. So couples who get married in their mid-20s report the highest levels of marital quality. And I think the conclusion that I would draw from that is that, you know, getting married a little bit older might be associated with kind of a maturity orientation, that is itself, you know, linked to a somewhat lower divorce risk. But getting married in your mid-20s sort of allows you as a couple to establish a common life together. And, you know, sort of that tradition of vacations or holidays or, you know, even kind of having kids and sort of establishing, you know, kind of an agreed upon approach to, you know, to work and professional life can be, you know, can be good.
Right. I mean, in your research, have you come across anything about attributes or qualities or that, you know, people should have before they go into a marriage? Because, like, I mean, I get a lot of letters from guys asking me, like, you know, I'm in my mid-20s, I'm thinking about getting married, but, like, all my friends say I'm too young. How do I know if I'm ready for marriage? So you mentioned, you know, have a little bit of working experience comes in handy, but anything else that lets you know, yeah, you might be ready for this commitment?
I think that guys who really do feel, you know, committed, deeply committed to this person, who are kind of want to, you know, go all out for her, is that's, you know, pretty important as an ingredient to marital success. I think guys who are kind of willing to cut back on other friendships to some extent, you know, and focus on this relationship in particular are also kind of signaling that they're ready for marriage. I think that guys who have, you know, made an effort to get to know their future spouse's, you know, parents and sort of signal their interest to them is also, that's a good sign. We also see too, the couples who enjoy shared religious attendance are more likely to be doing well, both in terms of the quality of their marriages and in terms of the stability of their marriages. So if you're, you know, if you're 22 or 23 and you're attending a church or a synagogue or a mosque together, and you share that common religious orientation commitment, that's going to tend to ground your marriage in ways that will, you know, put you in good shape for a common future together.
So we've talked about like getting married, but like, what do you do once you're married? Because like, you don't want to get divorced, because I think there's statistics out there, research shows that divorce for men can just be devastating. I mean, it can devastate your finances, obviously, for obvious reasons, but it can also devastate your mental and physical health also. So how do you avoid that? What can men do to foster a happy marriage?
Well, you know, I think one thing, of course, is when it comes to marriage, that men need to be sort of, you know, as do women, need to be careful. You know, I think we often make marriage decisions based upon how attractive someone is. And I'm not just saying physically, but, you know, that's really part of it, but sort of physical characteristics. You know, are they funny? Are they engaging? You know, are they sort of good in a social setting? You know, so it's easy to kind of put on a good front, you know, in public and or out on dates and things like that. But, you know, I think we have to be sort of discerning about whether or not this person has the character. Do they have virtues like, you know, fidelity? Do they have virtues like charity? Do they have virtues like thrift today, especially? Because those virtues are going to be much more predictive of a stable, happy marriage than looks or, you know, humor or whatnot. So I think, you know, one needs to be thinking about, do we have the kind of virtues and the kind of common interests, you know, whether it's sports or politics or hiking or, you know, religion, whatever, that will help ground a marital friendship. And so couples that have those virtues and that have those common interests, who can see themselves as friends when they're 75, old and ugly, will tend to do pretty well. By contrast, couples who I think are just drawn together by that sort of sexual romantic attraction are more likely to run into trouble. But then once you are married, I would say that generosity is certainly an important predictor of marital success. Shared faith can be an important predictor of marital success. Also, particularly the husband having a stable job, all these things tend to reduce the risk of divorce for couples after the wedding day.
All right. So love with your heart and your head is what you're saying.
Yeah. I would also add too that your friends matter a great deal. And I can remember reading that when Mark Sanford got into marital trouble down in South America, he was with a bunch of his male buddies and at this ranch in South America. And that's when he met, you know, the woman who helped break up his marriage, with whom, you know, had that affair. But I was just thinking, those guys clearly were not invested, you know, in his marriage. By contrast, you know, we all know friends who take our marriage, who take our family life pretty seriously. And so, you know, I think it's also important to think about the kinds of people you're hanging out with. Are they there for you and for your wife and your marriage, or are they likely to say things and do things that are going to put your marriage at risk? And so again, we know that sort of your social networks, they matter for a lot of things. One of the things that they matter for is your divorce risk. And if you have a friendship network that's, you know, takes marriage seriously, that's going to have a big impact on your own marriage.
Great. So let's shift to fatherhood now. I think all of us have read or heard somewhere that, you know, fathers are important in a child's development. But what specifically does a father bring to a child that a mother can't bring?
Well, you know, I was raised by a single mother, and I think that, you know, moms can do many of the things that dads can do, particularly in some kind of difficult situation, as my mom was, you know, was sort of put in when my father died when I was three. So, you know, moms can be firm. They can be decent disciplinarians. They can certainly play with their kids and all those things. But having said that, I think it's important for us to sort of understand that in the average family, you know, with the average father and the average mother, dads tend to excel in at least four different areas. They tend to still today excel when it comes to breadwinning. And of course, that matters for, you know, educating your kids, you know, paying for kids' extracurriculars, you know, all the kinds of financial things that go into raising children today. So, you know, the fact that he brings typically more money to the table is still an important factor for the average American father. Secondly, though, dads also tend to have kind of a leg up. This is kind of, again, more of an old school point, but tend to have a leg up when it comes to discipline. The size, physical size of men, the tone of their voice, and other kinds of features of men make them more likely to be the more authoritative disciplinarian in the average family. They're also more likely to be sort of sticklers for rules than our moms. And my point here is not to say that men are better disciplinarians than women, but they provide a different kind of discipline to their kids typically than do moms. And it's actually good for kids to experience kind of maternal discipline, which is a little bit more flexible oftentimes, a little bit less attentive to rules, more attentive to the situation, but also to experience dad's discipline, which tends to be a little bit less flexible and more rule-based, you know, and whatnot. So kids get, you know, I think a valuable experience by having both those styles of discipline. But thirdly, kind of moving beyond those sort of traditional points about men as breadwinners and men as disciplinarians in the home, we also are seeing today that when it comes to play, the power of play in kids' lives, that dads tend to be more likely to challenge their kids to sort of rough and engaging physical play. You know, so if you go to a local playground, for instance, a local park, you're more likely to see, you know, the dad of that toddler taking that toddler and throwing him up, you know, into the air, catching him to the toddler's squeals and laughter, and then, you know, and then doing that over again. Mom's much more likely to sort of attend to the toddler's physical well-being and security. So that kind of approach to play, you know, is great for kids. In fact, we know that kids who roughhouse with their dads tend to be more socially popular in a elementary school than kids who don't do a lot of roughhousing with their dads. So kind of learning how to handle their bodies, you know, and not bite, kick, you know, punch, et cetera, in that roughhousing context, I think seems to, you know, have some impact on kids' interactions on the playground and other places. And then fourth, we know that, you know, the dads do tend to kind of push their sons and their daughters to embrace life's challenges and life's opportunities, to kind of push them out of the nest, if you will. And so both, again, young men and young women who have come from well-fathered homes are more likely to flourish in school, and they're more likely to flourish in the labor force. So there's even, I think, a kind of almost a feminist case to make for having, you know, a good dad in the picture, because he tends to, you know, help his sons and his daughters prepare for the world outside the home.
So yeah, dads can provide a lot of benefits to children, but do men get any benefits, emotional, psychological, or otherwise, from being dads?
Well, I think, you know, for many men, fatherhood is enormously generative. And there's certainly ways in which I think when you are a father, you know, you can be stressed out. You can, you know, be temporarily unhappy by, you know, whatever challenge you're facing in terms of a child, you know, up at night, or a teenage you know, daughter or son who's giving you a lot of difficulty at home. But kind of from a longer term perspective, we see that dads are more likely to report that their lives are meaningful compared to men who don't have kids. And so I think that's that kind of, you know, that sense of meaning and purpose that one derives from fatherhood that, you know, is enormously important to, you know, to many of us.
So yeah. You make a distinction between meaningfulness and happiness. Cause I've seen that study that shows that, couples who have children, like their happiness level, like goes through this trough when they have kids, and when their kids leave their home, it goes back up. So I guess that's tracking like emotional happiness, like how well you feel on a day-to-day basis, not meaningfulness?
Yeah, I mean, I think it also, it's important to note, you know, that there is a lot of what we call kind of heterogeneity, you know, or a lot of variation in sort of the impact that kids have on couples and on individual mothers and fathers. But, you know, yeah, for many people, you know, having a kid can be obviously stressful and difficult. And it's particularly that first child that seems to be, you know, something that kind of reorients your whole life and makes you kind of transition into a new mode. What's interesting, I think, and surprising, though, is that work that I've done with some colleagues suggests that fathers of married fathers of larger families, four or more kids, seem to be more happily married than married dads with fewer kids. And frankly, that could be entirely a selection effect, by which I mean the kinds of men who are, you know, stably married and have lots of kids may just be, you know, more likely to enjoy family life, you know, more likely to, you know, to be intentional about investing on the home front. But it does suggest to us that, you know, it's not necessarily sort of the number of kids always, but maybe the approach one takes to family life that can be important here.
Are women with large families just as happy as men? I mean, I imagine they're the ones at home with watching the kids probably.
So in a report that the National Marriage Project did called When Baby Makes Three, we found that when it came to sort of happiness in marriage, that married couples with no kids and with four or more kids were happier. And this is true for both husbands and wives. So again, you know, it's not clear here if having a large family makes you happier, or I think this is actually probably more likely, if the kinds of couples who remain stably married and have lots of kids, they're probably just more intentional about, you know, family vacations, family traditions, you know, really investing in their, you know, in their common life together as a family, doing, you know, fun things, crazy things, et cetera, are probably the kinds of people who just are, you know, end up having more children and reporting happier marriages as a consequence.
Is there any research out there about, you know, when a couple knows when they're ready to have children? Like, are there attributes that a couple should have before they're like, okay, we're going to bring a kid into this relationship?
You know, I haven't seen anything really good on that score. I mean, I think that, you know, from my perspective, you know, once you've made that commitment to marry and gotten married, you know, and you have, you know, both sets of in-laws in a sense in your corner, you know, you're ready to go ahead and have that child. But I honestly haven't seen anything that kind of really looks carefully at the timing of childbirth and its, you know, impact on the quality or stability of married life for, you know, for couples.
I'm just curious, is there any piece of research that you came across or have, you know, done that the results surprised you in terms of men in marriage and men in fatherhood where you weren't expecting this result, but like you got it and you're like, wow, this is crazy.
The thing that's kind of most surprised me is that we've done some work internationally, a number of colleagues and I have, and I kind of assumed that across the world, kids would be more likely to be flourishing in school if they were part of a stably married family. And what we found is that in parts of the developing world, in parts of Latin America and Southern Africa and in Southern Asia, that wasn't always the case. Sometimes kids would do as well or better if they were being raised by, you know, a single mother. And as I explored that issue with some colleagues, what it looks like it might be is that, you know, in some places, there's not a great expectation for the father to be really involved with his kids' education or to devote his, you know, his money to, you know, to the kids' education. So in those contexts, perhaps, you know, having a father in the household isn't always going to be helpful on the educational front. So that was kind of, it was eye-opening for me, just basically signaled that when we're thinking about something like marriage and family structure, we also have to attend to the culture, you know, and to the family process. And so a culture that basically encourages men to be considerate, responsible, self-sacrificing husbands and fathers is going to be one where I think, generally speaking, you know, women and children are more likely to flourish. But if a culture encourages men to be more macho, or not to really attend, in deep ways to their wife or to their children, we can't expect that the presence of a father will always, or will typically always be linked to better outcomes for women or children.
So, I mean, what's the state of American fatherhood today? I mean, has it changed? Like, what we expect from dads, has it changed from, say, 1950s? Like, what's the cultural expectation, I guess, of dads?
Yeah. So in terms of American fatherhood today, I would say it's the best of times and it's the worst of times. And a lot of, whether it's the best of times, for kids, the worst of times for kids depends upon your zip code. And so if you're in a zip code that's more affluent and more educated or more religious, you're in a place where typically fathers are, spending more time with their kids than ever. And in some ways are more, more affectionate and more attentive to their children than ever. And in many respects, that's obviously a good thing. But if you're in other zip codes, this is true for, African-American kids, white kids, Hispanic kids, you're going to find a world where, dads are not stably connected to their children. They don't necessarily live with their kids. They often might not see their kids on a weekly basis. And, in those working class and poor zip codes, in some ways it's the worst of times, for American fatherhood, because kids are not able to have strong and stable and abiding connections to their fathers. They don't wake up in the morning with dad, next to them, or dad in the next room. And those kids, are more likely to flounder in school and more likely to end up, incarcerated, more likely to have difficulty in the labor force, because they didn't have the opportunity or the privilege of having a, a good relationship, a stable relationship with their dad. So, it really is a kind of a, the picture for American fatherhood really is, pretty, schizophrenic, if you will.
And, part of what you're doing with your work with the Institute of Family Studies and the Marriage Project is to help, provide policy suggestions to promote marriage. We talked about that, but like anything that your all's institute has suggested is for policy changes to encourage fatherhood, or that sort of ideal of fatherhood that you're striving for?
Well, I think in terms of public policy, measures, it's important to note that at the end of the day, what happens probably in Los Angeles is more important than what happens in Washington, D.C. To recognize that the culture, pop culture, has a bigger role in affecting, how Americans sort of approach family life than does what happens, up on Capitol Hill in Washington, D.C. or in the White House. But having said that, it's important to recognize that we could do, I think, a better job on the policy front. And I think in particular, there are two things that we could do better. One is, I think, as I mentioned before, just to do a better job of educating young women and young men who are not on that college track, in terms of better vocational education, better apprenticeship training, better efforts to connect them to jobs out there that pay a decent wage, whether it's, being a plumber, being an electrician, doing advanced IT work or advanced manufacturing, or some other kind of job that pays a decent, a good wage, and makes, our young adults more likely to to be good prospects for marriage. A second point, though, I think, is to sort of think very seriously and deeply about the way in which our welfare system, I'm using welfare in the broadest possible sense of that word, may unintentionally discourage or penalize marriage. And so because we do have income, thresholds, if you will, where if your income goes above a certain threshold, you tend to lose access to to some kinds of assistance, or it tends to taper. What that means is that in practice, policies like Medicaid or food stamps, or in fewer cases, cash welfare, can end up you know, subtly, I think, discouraging, or not necessarily discouraging marriage. You know, talking to people who, working class couples who say, you know, we're sort of thinking about marriage, but we, you know, we're sort of concerned too that we're going to lose access to Medicaid, you know, if we go ahead and get married. And, you know, that can be a big, obviously, concern when you're having a child, or when you already have one or two kids. So from a public policy vantage point, I think we should do more to try to minimize or eliminate the marriage penalty facing working class and poor families, you know, as one way to make our public policies more marriage friendly.
Well, Brad, this has been a great conversation. We scratched the surface. Where can people learn more about your work?
I think the best place to go to really understand the work of the Institute for Family Studies is family-studies.org. On the internet, I'm also on Twitter at Wilcox NMP. And those are two good places to sort of learn more about the research that we're doing on marriage, cohabitation, and fatherhood, both in America and around the globe.
Fantastic. Brad Wilcox, thank you so much for your time. It's been a pleasure.
It's great to be on with you today, Brett.
My guest today was Brad Wilcox. He's the director of the National Marriage Project. You can find more information about that at nationalmarriageproject.org. He also works with the Institute of Family Studies, and you can find more information about them at family-studies.org. And you can download that study about men and marriage there. That we referenced. So go check that out.